I want to do a comparison for you guys, because I believe right now we're on the verge of we're on the verge of a crossing over time, moving, transitioning. Some things are about to happen, and I want to make some comparisons. You know, we live in the time of Mystery Babylon. Your Bible says the Lord's going to return, and during that time, Mystery Babylon is going to, you know, be where it is right now. It's ruling and reigning here on earth. But I want to make a comparison with Babylon and what happened with Nimrod over there, you know, and the day of Pentecost, what happened. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and forth and show you Babylon and Israel. Okay? Check this out. And you guys can read this in Genesis chapter 11 about Nimrod, and I'm going to talk a little bit about him. And you can read it in Acts chapter 2. Because what had happened in Babylon, during the Tower of Babel, was an exact repeat of what happened in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. Now check this out. In Babylon, they built a tower, right? In Babylon, they built a tower. In Israel, the disciples, Jesus had told them to go and stay in the upper room, right? So here we got a tower, and over here in Jerusalem, they're in the upper room. In Babylon, it starts off in Genesis chapter 11. In the upper room, they have 11 apostles, right? Watch this. In Babylon, it says, Josephus says, Flavius, that there was a mighty wind that came through and wrecked the tower and took and confounded the languages. Now, if you'd like me to read that to you, in fact, Zechariah, go in my truck and get Josephus' book. Go get my book on the back seat of the truck, Josephus Flavius. So there was a rushing mighty wind that came at Babylon, and there was a rushing mighty wind that came into when they was all in the upper room. And the Bible says, Jesus says in John chapter 3 verse 8, which was quoted today, that Jesus said, the wind bloweth where it wants, but you don't know. And that wind is the Spirit of God, the Ruach HaKodesh. So it was the Holy Spirit that came down on the Tower of Babel, was the same Holy Spirit that came in the upper room. Okay? Now, let me say this, that the sign that the Holy Spirit had come wasn't they began to speak with other languages. It was the sound of the rushing mighty wind. And if you go in the Old Testament, or the Old Covenant, it's not an Old Testament, you go in the Old Covenant, you'll find out that the wind is the Ruach HaKodesh. So you see that in Babylon, there was a mighty wind that came through, and Josephus says it destroyed the tower and confounded their languages. And then we see in Israel, a rushing mighty wind had came, right? And they all spoke with tongues, with divided tongues. In Babylon, which means confusion, it says that the tongues was confounded. That means they was their tongues was confounded there, right? And what they heard, they couldn't understand one another. But in Israel, it says their tongues was interpreted. So what I'm saying is, when the Spirit came at Babylon, he confounded the languages. It's the Holy Spirit that divided the languages, and that's why in the upper room on the day of Pentecost, it showed cloven-like tongues. That was another sign. Cloven is divided, right? Tongues. and they all began to speak with other languages. So here we got a division of languages at the Tower of Babel. Here it is, we got divided languages, but now, where they couldn't understand one another at Babel, now there are many people that are gathered, even out of Mesopotamia in Acts chapter 2, and they begin to speak in their own in tongues, and it says the men and brethren that were gathered begin to hear the gospel preached in their own language, and they were confounded. Wow. They were confounded at Babel. They're confounded over here in Israel. Why were they confounded? They were confounded because they said, aren't these men all Galileans and speak the Galilean language? And we're hearing the wonderful works of God being preached in our own language. Wow. So there was confusion at Babel. There was confusion in the at the upper room, the men in the languages that were gathered. Right? There was a wind there. There was a wind in Israel. Now, let me tell you what Josephus says. So, and I'll give you the, he says about the Tower of Babel. This is on page Josephus Flavius, the complete work. This is an enlarged type, Antiquity of Jews. It says on page 30. And it talks about the Tower of Babel and what happened. It says that when all men were of one language, some of them built a high tower, as if they would thereby ascend up into heaven. But the gods sent storms of wind and overthrew the tower and gave everyone his peculiar language. So even Josephus says a strong wind is what divided the languages. Wow. That's it. It gets good. And I'm showing you it's one and the same, but it's going to lead someplace. It says, so there was a tower then, an upper room in Jerusalem, in Israel. This was in Genesis 11. There was 11 apostles. A mighty wind had came through. Josephus says there was a rushing mighty wind in Israel that came. Tongues, number four, tongues had been confounded. They were confused about what they heard. We see the confusion when they begin to speak in tongues. Remember, men and brethren, these are not, you know, drunk as you're supposed to be, and it's about 9 o'clock in the morning. But it's Peter who interprets what it is. This is what was spoken of by the prophet Joel, that your sons and daughters would prophesy, would preach the gospel. Now, Jesus said the gift that would be given, when the Holy Spirit had come, it says that he would enable you to preach the gospel, right? That would be the sign. We would be empowered from on high, would be endued with power to be able to preach the gospel. Now, most people think that the sign the Holy Spirit had come was tongues. Wrong. The sign the Holy Spirit had come was the rushing mighty wind. That was the gift. Jesus said, go away till you be endued with power. And there came a wind. Jesus explained what the wind was. In John chapter 3, verse 8, he said, it's the Spirit. So the sound of the rushing mighty wind, there was a sound of a rushing mighty wind that filled the whole house, right? How do we know? Another place is in Acts chapter 4. And when they prayed for boldness, there was the whole house shook. Why? Because of the wind that came in. And they all was endued with power to preach with boldness. The sound of the Spirit, or the evidence that the Spirit had come, was the rushing mighty wind. Right. So now, we see, because the Spirit had come, number five, they were dispersed, meaning they were separated, and that was at Babel. But now we see that in Israel, on the same exact day, thousands of years later, now it's by the Holy Spirit where he caused the dispersion, because they were building Nimrod's kingdom. Now, with building the kingdom of Jesus Christ, the wind comes, or the Holy Spirit comes, and now they begin to hear the gospel preached in their own language. So there was a division here, and now there's a bringing back together in Israel, right? Now, in Genesis chapter 11, God said, come and let us go down and see what it is that man's doing. And we see that in Acts chapter 2, it says the Holy Spirit came down. You understand? Same thing. In Babylon, the Lord said the people are one. In Acts chapter 2, the Bible says that they were all in one accord in the upper room. Wow. Unity in building. Unity in building. If you're not in unity, if a house is divided, it can't stand, right? You walk by yourself and you fall, well, you're in trouble. Even Charlene talked about today. Doesn't two can represent, you know, division? Yes. You better believe it can. Because if we're divided in what we've been called to do, well, then we can't build. We don't speak the same language. And it could be affected. It could be affected by your view. If you have a heavenly view, we'll build the kingdom of Jesus Christ. If you have an earthly view, you're going to build Nimrod's kingdom, Satan's kingdom, man's kingdom. And if you have a worm's view and you're in the ground, you ain't building no kingdom. You understand? Some people are divided because they don't have a heavenly view. They think they do, but they don't. So they cause division in the church. All right. Number 7, I said the Lord said the people are one. And once they become one, they can build anything they want. Now whatever they put their mind to, you know, they won't be able to be stopped. That's letting you and I know, once we become one in Jesus Christ. Now we're not going to agree. We all have different little things, but we're building the kingdom. Can you sit in a place where the kingdom is being built, and though you differ from what is being built, you know, as far as your opinion, can you still work with that? Or do you have to have it your way? Well then, if you have to have it your way, well then, you're going to cause a division. Because you're not speaking the same language as the pastor. And the pastor got to be speaking the language of Jesus Christ. Because that's the only one the Holy Spirit gets behind. Number 8. They were building a kingdom. It says that Nimrod was the first king. That's what it said. Nimrod was the first king. And the kingdom of Nimrod was built. Right? So Nimrod. It says they were building a kingdom. The kingdom of Nimrod. Check this out. Nimrod, his name means strong. Right? And it says that he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. So his name means strong. They were building his kingdom, a tower to reach the heavens. So a tower is in the atmosphere. The Bible says that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. Nimrod was building his kingdom to reach into the heavens to overthrow God. Josephus said that he was building a tower. He pitched it so that if God decided to flood the earth again, it would be waterproof. And when he got up there, he was going to wring God's neck. He was going to take vengeance out on God because of what he had done to his forefathers. He was a giant. He was a Nephilim. And Nimrod is depicted holding a lion in his arm. Now Nimrod, his name means strong. He's depicted holding a lion and he's a mighty hunter. The Bible says that Satan is a mighty hunter, a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Amen. Nimrod was a picture of Satan. Nimrod was building Satan's kingdom. That's what was happening at that time on that day. At Jerusalem, at 2,000 years ago, on the very same day, the Holy Spirit came down again. But this time, they were all in one accord to build the kingdom of Jesus Christ. That's the kingdom that I build. No other foundation. Number 9, It happened on Pentecost Day in Babylon. And in Israel, it happened on Pentecost, the same day. Number 10, it happened after Noah's flood, after 120 years, right? Well, on Pentecost, the same day, there was 120 in the upper room. You with me? Right? It says, number 11, Abraham was called out of Babylon, right? And where was he taken to? Jerusalem, but the land that flows with milk and honey. So Abraham, the kingdom that leave your father and your kindred and your family and that Babylonian system, and I'm going to bring you to a land where you can build, you know, where he's looking for a city and maker who's God. That's right, the foundations and cities in Hebrews, whose builder and maker is God. So he ain't looking for Babylon, right? He left Babylon. And when you leave the system of Babylon, you might have to leave your mother, brother, sister, and family. Yeah. Abraham, where are you going? I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? He couldn't see the city, but he believed God. You and I are building a city we can't see with our eyes. Amen. And we're looking for a new holy city. Wow. God is showing us that Babylon is now, we have a representation of it over there in Israel. There's a system that's even being built there. In fact, Jesus himself called Jerusalem Sodom in Egypt.
Okay.
Sodom in Egypt. And Sodom in Egypt is the same Babylonian system. Babylon had the Egyptian system that was in place, man's government. So, with Babylon, they were building and worshiping the gods over there. Egypt, they was building pyramids and worshiping the gods there. And I want to throw this at you. You ever thought about why there's pyramids built all around in the world, everywhere you go? That's either a straight, you know, pyramid or step pyramid. The Lord had showed me this a long time ago. It says that the new holy city, Jerusalem, is four square, right? And it talks about there's three gates on the north, the south, the east, and the west. And it says that in Revelation, that city, the new holy city, Jerusalem, it gives you the cubits of it, but it spells out in our miles. It's 1,377 miles north, then south, then east, then west. So when a new holy city comes down, that's how big it is. 1,377 miles. Even the new holy city, Jerusalem, right now would come down on modern day Jerusalem, where you are standing at right now today, you can physically see the city. You could. Because it says not only does it go 1,377 miles north, south, east, and west in Revelation, but it goes 1,377 miles straight up. Now, from here to Tennessee is only 600 miles or so. So it's two times as far. That's about 20 hours to go about 1,400 miles. 22 hours to go around there, say. Now, think about that. If you drove right now 22 hours, you'd just hit the other side of the city wall of the new holy city, Jerusalem. Personally, I believe the new holy city, Jerusalem, is a pyramid. That's what I believe. And I'll tell you why. I'm kind of getting off the message that maybe it's... I even built it. A big model representation of it. I made it out of clear plexiglass. I made a big old pyramid out of clear plexi and built all the inside and put a river in it that actually operated with a pump and made the whole thing with different colored stone, 12 layers of stone that came up. I believe, remember when in Revelations it says, and I'm getting off track, remember in Revelations it says that the angel said unto John, come and let us Come and let us go. Pete said, I'm chasing the rabbit, I'm going down a rabbit hole. Come and let us go unto the mountain of the Lord. Everywhere, when you go to see God, he's at Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb, right? Mount Moriah, the Mount of Olives. When you look at the mountain or you look at a pyramid from a distance, it looks like a mountain. When John was going to take, when the angel was going to, in Revelation, was going to take John, do you want to see the Lamb's wife, the new holy city, the bride? What he said, and he taketh me to a high mountain. Wow. A pyramid. You know, even Illuminati, those guys say, as above, so below. Is it a possibility? That's why when the angels came down, they built, the fallen angels took the sons of God, you know, and the daughters of men, and they began to build pyramids everywhere around the world. Why? Because it was where they were cast out of, the new holy city, Jerusalem. Right? It's always about a mountain. Right? Wow. You know, the Tower of Babel, it wasn't a skyscraper straight up. Right? No. It was a ziggurat, or it was a round circle that was big on the bottom and then rolled up to the top. Why is it always about triangles? Because I believe personally, the new holy city, Jerusalem, when it comes down, it's a pyramid. It looks like a pyramid. And I'm going to tell you another thing. All altars, when they built altars, they would build them. In fact, and I'm just quoting the book of Enoch. Enoch says that the pyramid in Giza is actually an altar. In fact, it says, Enoch says, and I don't want to get off track, but Enoch says that when the sons of God came to him and asked him, you know, would you pray for us? He had him build an altar unto the Lord, and that altar that's built, if you look at that pyramid in Giza, it's flat on the top. It was a pyramid that was built up so he can go up and make a sacrifice of God. He could speak to God on their behalf. And then, you know, Enoch goes into this big old deal. But I don't want to get away from all that. Anyway, just something you could check out. I believe the new holy city is a pyramid. It's perfect in its mass. That's another thing. And you try to get somebody to build one today. I've physically watched brick masons was challenged to build a pyramid that was the same distance around, the same height, and make it come, and they couldn't do it. They said, there's no possible way. They said, don't tell me, it's over there in Giza in Egypt. Now, you build a pyramid that's the same at the base, and is the same rake going up the corner like that to the peak. It's the same dimension. They said, it's physically impossible. You can't do it. Don't say you can't do it. It's over there. So it takes someone of great mathematics to be able to do it. So anyway, let me get back to where I was at. So God is, that's a big city that we're looking for, you know. It says, number 12, Peter, oh my Lord. I'm going to hold off on that one because that's going to blow your doors off. This is the crowning of the pyramid, yeah. It says in 13, I'm going to skip 12. 13 says, and they left off building the tower and were scattered. But in Israel, Peter the apostle, he preaches to the strangers that are scattered. Wow. You see scattered at the Tower of Babel, and you see scattered again over here in Acts chapter 2, the same word. Isn't it funny? He's using the same word. They were scattered in Babylon by the Holy Spirit, were called back together by the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. There were divided tongues with no interpreter at Babylon. There was cloven tongues that was given to us with the gift of interpretation that was given, right? So they had no interpreter at the Tower of Babel, but the Holy Spirit, which is the gift, he is our interpreter. He brings everybody back together, right? It took the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost to use one of the gifts so that that gift that the Holy Spirit had divided then, it would take him to give the gift to those to be able to preach the language that they could understand to bring us back together again. They left off building at the Tower of Babel. They began building on Pentecost in Israel, but building the kingdom of Jesus Christ, right? They built under the head of Nimrod. I told you that was, in his name, it's a strong roaring lion who was a picture of Satan, who is a hunter, a mighty, seeking whom he may devour. We build under the headship of Christ, who is the lion of the tribe of Judah. And we give him the praise, not Nimrod, not Satan. And I wrote right here. You see, Peter was given the keys to the kingdom. Peter had the key. He understood. Peter I'm going to tell you something about Peter that's absolutely going to blow your mind. Peter, the reason Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost is because he understood what was happening. Peter was the only one that was able to make the connection between what was going on in Israel on the day of Pentecost to the Tower of Babel. He understood. Peter knew that it was the Holy Spirit that came down and divided the languages at the Tower of Babel. Peter was now seeing what is happening now is what happened at the Tower of Babel. He was the only one that made the connection. That's why he stood up and preached. Watch this. Peter is so blown away by it that he says, "Men and brethren, these men are not drunk as ye suppose, seeing it's about the ninth hour. But this is what was promised to us, that your sons and daughters would prophesy or preach the gospel, and that, you know, throughout the whole world." Why throughout the whole world? First in Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. Why? Because it was at the Tower of Babel they were scattered. So Peter, being so blown away, he writes a letter. Open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. So, Peter starts off his letter and says this: "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ." So he's making a declaration. He's building the kingdom of Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is the chief apostle. So he ain't building no other kingdom. That's what that means right there. "To the strangers that are scattered." Wow. Where were the people scattered? He's using the same word, right? Scattered, divided, throughout Pontus and Galatia and Cappadocia and Asia and Bithynia. Now, I'm going to stop right there, because he's writing a letter to those that are scattered abroad. Now watch this. I'm going to go to, y'all hold that place, I'm going to go to Acts 2. I'm going to show you who he's writing to. Because Peter writes the first letter, and he says this. Now, He says, and when the, chapter, verse 1, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord. Sound like Babylon? They were of one mind. They were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound. So a sound came first from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. Josephus Flavius said it was a mighty wind. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them divided tongues like unto fire. Why fire? Why fire? A divided tongue. Why fire? Because a fire licks. And when it licks, it looks like a tongue. And the Bible says that the whole world is set on fire by the tongue. Our God is a consuming fire. Amen. The Bible says the Word of God, the tongue of God, is a fire. So God, when it came down, He was wanting them to know beyond the shadow of a doubt. Amen. They saw something that was divided. It was divided fire. It was tongues. They knew what it represented, or Peter did. Watch this. It's going to blow you away. It blew me away. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues. Where was the tongues divided? At Babylon. This has got to be a direct connection. It's the only other time they heard of divided tongues. This is Peter making a connection back to Babylon. He's got it. He understands it. But they don't. Jesus Christ gave him the key. Watch this. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews. Jews. Oh. Jews. And these Jews were devout men. Out of every nation under heaven. What? They were divided. They were all over the place. And now God brought them there to bring them back together again. Right? Where were they at? Well, let's see. And they were dwelling at Jerusalem out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, spoken about, the multitude came together and they were confounded. Wow, confused. That's that word. They were confused. Where were they confused first? At Babel. Right? Because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? Galilee, or Galilee, means circle or circuit. From Babylon to Pentecost in Israel was a complete circuit or cycle, was starting again. Wow. Watch. And how we hear every man in our own tongue. Dialect is the word. Wherein we're born. The Parthians and the Medes and the Elamites and dwellers of Mesopotamia, Babylon. Who's Peter writing to? People that have been scattered? Wow. So let's check out his letter now. So, Peter, verse 2, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit. He's already connecting the Spirit of what had happened. elect according to the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that's doing the work. You understand? Without Him, we can do nothing. Through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience. You have to be obedient, or you won't walk in power. The Holy Spirit will not accompany you. Amen. And when He shuts down, it was a perfect example of what happened to me last week. I can do nothing without Him. You hear me? Even all the knowledge that I have and understanding in God's Word wrote down in front of me, I couldn't even preach this message because He said no. He stopped me. I'm falling on my words. I couldn't even make sense of what I was saying myself. I was confused, confounded, because He wasn't working through me no more. Watch this. Unto obedience and the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace be unto you and peace be multiplied. You see, the whole Spirit, the whole reason the Holy Spirit came was to bring us back together again, so we can unite under the banner of Jesus Christ, not and come out of the Babylonian system, the Egyptian system in which the whole world is in today. If you're not in Jesus Christ, you're under the Nimrod system. You're under the Egyptian system because they're all intertwined into one head, and that head is Lucifer. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy, He's begotten unto us again, unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That's how we're brought back together. To an inheritance that's incorruptible, that's heaven, and undefiled, and that does not fade away. Babylon faded away. No more. Reserved in heaven for you and me, who are kept by the power of God, that's the Holy Spirit, through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, as persecution. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold, that it perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So, remember the scripture I said, whether we have bread on our table or not, was kept through Him. Whom having you've not seen, but yet you love Him. In whom, though now you see Him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. That's what I live for. I live to see His face. I don't live for heaven. I live for Him. Because heaven without Him is no heaven. What's heaven without Jesus Christ? Of which salvation that He's talking about, Peter is explaining, of which, or should I say, this salvation, the prophets had inquired. They wanted to know about it. And they searched diligently who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. The prophets were trying to find out what it all meant. They were prophesying it, but didn't really understand it. Searching what, or what manner of time, the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify. The Spirit spoke through them in old, and they gave prophecies pointing to Jesus Christ. They didn't understand it, yet they sought for it diligently. Like you and me should be doing. When it testified beforehand the sufferings of Jesus Christ, His death, and the glory that should follow, His resurrection, His over death, over the sting of sin. Right? Watch this. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto them, they didn't understand it, but unto us, they did minister these things. Those prophets of old are ministering to us today. How? Which are now reported. Peter is the one that stood up and explained what was going on. He's saying, which now is reported. I'm reporting unto you, and they are reporting unto you what the prophets spoke of old. Right? Well, how? Which now are reported unto you by them, the 120, that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Angels don't understand the redemption of man. They've always been with God, and those that was with God and fallen, they cannot be redeemed because they left the glory they have seen and denied him. There's therefore now no salvation that can come unto them, though they even seek it with tears and ask an Enoch to pray for them. No! But you and me, we have a chance. Born in sin, not even seeing it, believing it, we're crying out and looking for it. We have hope, they have none. And it was through the Holy Spirit that took the tongues away back then and caused division, now gives them the gift of tongues to be able to preach the gospel. Is that not amazing? Now I'm going to show you something that's so absolutely mind-blowing. And I'm done. Peter understood it all. Remember, Peter was sent to who? The Jews. Paul was sent to the Gentiles. You remember at the dispersion of the Babylonian kingdom, Josephus says there was only two tribes taken to Babylon. 10 tribes of the northern part. Israel was divided in northern and southern tribes. The only two tribes that was taken to Babylon was Benjamin and Judah. Wow. Judah. Jesus come from the line of the tribe of Judah. And all those that was a picture of Christ basically came from Benjamin. David was a Benjamite. That's where they made the bread from. That's where all the lambs that was sacrificed in the temple came from, Bethlehem. That's why Jesus was born in Bethlehem. He's a lamb. He's the bread. In fact, Bethlehem has another name. It's called Heaven's Oven. Heaven's Oven. Yeah, I learned that in Jerusalem when I was there. House of Bread is what everybody knows, but it's also called Heaven's Oven. And it's called Heaven's Oven because they'd put the bread down on the showbread table, and on the seventh day they would replace it. And when they picked it up, it was like it came out the oven. It was warm. Right, that's how good the bread is. Angels' food. Peter has an understanding that is so absolutely amazing that it caused me now, I have to go back and reread Peter. Blew me away. Now, I gave you the beginning of 1 Peter. Now let me give you the end, the benediction, the last four verses in Peter, 1 Peter, chapter 5, verse 10 through 14. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10 through 14, which most people won't even read. You know what's amazing about 1 Peter? He doesn't say anything about false teachers. It's in 2 Peter. But we know that when in Babylon, when they was called out of Babylon after being in captivity for 70 years, like they was in Egypt, they was in captivity for 430 years, but actually about 250 of those years, they actually became part of the system. They was in government, ruling and reigning with them. And they had built houses and families and children and all kind of thing in Egypt. So when God called them out, they always wanted to go back. Same thing with Babylon. After the 70 years were up, Daniel had interpreted Jeremiah. Jeremiah said they would be in captivity for 70 years. So now, after the 70 years, when Daniel interprets it and understands it, now it's time to come out of Babylon. So there's a call out of Babylon. But guess what? They become part of the system. How many people are stuck in the system today and won't come out of Babylon? You think Babylon's just a place? I tell you, no. It's a system throughout the whole world. Because in the end, it's you're only going to be serving one. Either you take his mark or you don't. It's called a new world order, a Babylonian system. And the only way you can come out of that system is through Jesus Christ. And it's always a call to come out of her, my people. But guess what? Out of, there was 42,000 that left Babylon after being in captivity for 70 years, when there was probably around 600,000. Only a remnant. Only a remnant came out. Isn't it something that wise men from Mesopotamia, Babylon, came looking for the king? Amen. They were Jews. They were Jews. They learned the scriptures from Daniel. They knew. Now, they wouldn't have been alive during Babylon. 70 years prior, they're in this Babylonian captivity. We know they went in captivity 586 B.C., right? They was in captivity till around, 70 years from the 586. So it's still almost 600 years before Jesus Christ comes, right? So now all of these Jews that are over there are multiplying. A lot of them became part of the system. And when the call was to come out of her, my people, they didn't come. But you know what happened shortly after that? King Nebuchadnezzar dies. And Belshazzar takes over his son and takes the temple goblets and throws a big party. And that party wasn't good. It was unclean, very unclean. And that very night, there was a hand that wrote on the wall. What was it? Meeny, check or something. The hand wrote on the wall, today, tonight, you've been found in the scales, O king, and found wanting. And that very night, he was killed by the Medes and the Persians. They came in and wiped out the city. The Jews were just called out, but they chose to stay in bondage. And the system, and the pleasures, and the gardens, and everything that they had there. And judgment was about to fall. God calling the people out of Babylon. Come out of her, or you're going to be judged. There's only one way out, and that's through Jesus Christ. Amen, brother. Because when he comes in, when he comes back, we go out. And judgment hits, just like it did in Egypt. You understand? Now, I'm going to show you how much understanding Peter had. Watch this. Verse 10. No. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory, that's the call out, by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, and it may make you perfect and establish you and strengthen and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silas, this letter is coming also. By Silas, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein ye stand. Peter wrote it.
the church that is in Babylon, elected together with you, saluteth you. Peter went to Babylon. He wrote the letter from Babylon. You don't think he had an understanding of what happened on the day of Pentecost? Oh my God, son. He sees what happens in Jerusalem. He is so blown away. Oh my God, this is exactly what happened in Babylon. He goes to Babylon. He goes to Babylon. This letter was written from Peter's hand, an explanation of what happened on the day of Pentecost from Babylon. I said, did you heard me? My God is bad, son. In all the years I've been reading, God just decided to show me a little something that absolutely blew my doors off. There is no way in the world possible you can convince me that the first book of Peter means anything else. Peter explained it. I preached it. I talked about tongues, what they were and what it was symbolic to. It has nothing to do with your salvation. Nothing. It was one of the gifts that operated. It was the promise that the Holy Spirit was going to come and endue them with power. Sons and women can preach the gospel. Grab a hold of this. Why does Peter leave Jerusalem? They're being persecuted. Where does this guy go? Man, I'm going to Babylon. He got something to say. He's going to tell the Jews that are in Babylon that remained. Remember what Moses wrote about the Tower of Babel and all of this? That's where he goes. He goes. First, he goes to those of the tribe of Judah and Benjamin and set the church up in Iraq and Babylon. And then, after he does that, he goes on his missionary journeys, which was probably about 30 years or so before he writes the second letter, and he's about to be crucified upside down. Peter holds the key. Anybody got some keys in here? I'm going to show you something that's so absolutely amazing. He was given the key. And we know the key is Jesus Christ. And the only way a key can open a door is got to be put in and turned upside down. And that's why he was crucified upside down. You understand? That last part right there I learned from Jonathan Cleck blew me away. The key. He said, I'm not worthy. But he was the one that God gave the keys to that opened the door, right? And a key, in order for it to work, has got to be put in, number one. And we talked about John knocking on a door, right? The key's got to be put in and turned upside down. This world system has been turned upside down, but God is going to turn it right side up. You understand? He's the key. Father, you are so good. And Lord, the message today was, wow. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And I think that's what the Lord is saying. He's at the door right now. He's at the door of his coming. He's at the door of his return. And we're about to see him face to face. I didn't understand it this morning. why I was like, I just want to see his face. It's because he's saying, I'm coming. Are you ready to see him, really? Are you ready to see him? You, Father, are amazing. Even our sight today. Even about the message of Ecclesiastes and dying and all being in vain. And the whole message that was taught in class today was about death and crossing over. Because we're about to see it. Amen, amen, and amen. I love you, God.